Children on Y254, it is the last segment now. Ni kipindi cha lala salama. Na kipindi cha lala salama, we are going to talk about matches that bring you happy moments and emotional moments too. But take care of that lad, because it's very, very key. A very good afternoon, a day where Arsenal fans are really confident. I don't know what is making them confident in everything that is happening today, but let's understand why they are confident. Joining me here in studio for the Fan Zone for the first time this year, I think, is Joe Saina, right?
Yes, first time this year.
Yep. Ah, big one for you. And then I've got Sammy Gitai also, first time this year doing the touchline.
Yeah.
What has been your highlight of the week?
Well,
that is well, spokesman.
You have to understand something. The team that was put out was not supposed to be defeated by Sheffield United.
Yes,
it was supposed to win.
To win,
they let down the manager.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yes.
The team that was put out against Liverpool by Tottenham were not ready to win that game.
Uh-huh.
They don't get out of that point.
Yeah.
The formation system of Tottenham, that's why they lost.
Yeah.
Okay, and we're going to touch on it much later. Arsenal's win.
Yeah.
My brother, have you seen how they're walking around?
Yeah.
These Arsenal fans. You can think they've won the league, man.
I've seen almost 20 fans out there with Arsenal jerseys, but I understand them.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a weird season and they are now on a very good run. Six games in a row they haven't lost.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be tough for them. They're going to get with it.
Mm-hmm. And then you have these two light blue people walking around with this jersey of Manchester City.
Yeah.
People are not even around for the last 2-3 months. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, mm-hmm. Hey, Man City are going to win the title, which is a lie.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. Mm-hmm. After this weekend, they are only top for 2 days.
Yeah.
Let them enjoy this last how many hours? Maybe 2 to 3 hours.
2 to 3 hours.
We're getting back there.
Yeah. Big game. We'll be talking about that game. Just a sneak peek of what we are going to talk about. It's our main game here tonight. Oh, we can just go ahead and finish with that game.
Mm.
How do you see Manchester United lining up tonight?
Well, definitely, what we need to understand is Arsenal are going to beef up their defense.
Yes.
Because Arsenal, to them, picking up a point again in this game will be quite important. You know, 31 points right now isn't that bad for them, but they can do much better. So I'm looking at, first of all, Cavani has to start.
Yeah,
he has to start.
Yeah.
What Martial, what, no, Cavani has to start.
Yeah.
They need to get the ball to him.
Mm-hmm.
He can hold up play. He can still do the conversions.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, he can bring in the likes of Fernandes, the likes of Pogba.
Yes.
But we need Cavani to start.
Yeah.
That's 1-2.
Yeah.
That makeshift partnership of Maguire and Transebe has to stop. Okay? Bailly has to start today, or Lindelof has to start.
Mm-hmm.
De Gea has to be at his top game.
Mm-hmm.
That mistake that led to that first goal,
yes,
we cannot forget some few things.
Yeah.
Okay, so because he's going to start today,
yeah,
they're not going to start Henderson,
yeah,
so he needs to be top of his game, because Arsenal are coming in. We're going to Emirates.
Yeah.
They're going to make sure, first of all, they shut up shop,
mm-hmm,
then they embarrass United.
Yeah,
because if they win today, they go up to fifth position, 33,
and then during the week after Manchester United lost to Sheffield United, Anthony Martial was subjected to some ratios in that they said this kid has cost Manchester United the title. Do you believe that?
Wow.
After that loss to Sheffield.
That's a heavy statement when you say that they have cost Manchester United a title.
Mm-hmm.
First off, at the beginning of the season, no one would have said that Manchester United are going to win the title.
Yeah.
And I don't know where this conversation has come from, and I guess it's not
about
from Manchester United fans.
Yeah.
It has to be rival fans who've been getting on that joy of Manchester United winning 13 games in a row or something.
Yeah.
But for Anthony Martial, yes, I understand he's on a downward spiral at this moment. He's not really a number nine, and I guess that's why we are seeing such bad form on his side.
Yeah.
He works best when he's playing on the left side, and I guess that's the situation with him right now, that he just doesn't get at the end of balls most of the time.
Yes.
And his body language at times looks as if he's not really happy playing at that position. I understand the frustration from the fans, and that's where we maybe expect a very gutsy call from Ole Gunnar Solskjaer tonight.
And then the big one is Arsenal just signed Martin Odegaard from Real Sociedad, is coming in as a midfielder. for them, their lineup today? Can you predict?
Well, if they're going to include him, if he's going to start, which I think it's a doubt, he will be their natural number 10.
Yeah.
You know, he'll come in, offer those right balls that the likes of Aubameyang need, the likes of Saka, Pepe being on the left again, he performed very well in midweek.
Yeah.
I don't see Arsenal changing so much of that starting lineup. It worked really well.
Yes.
Especially Saka, the balls that he was getting, Bellerin hitting that right side. You looked at Pepe, you know, rejuvenation again, from obviously having a very bad season. I don't think they'll change so much today. I think I would stick with the same squad if I was Mikel Arteta.
Well, maybe for me, I guess the only place maybe that he could think around maybe is on the left-back position. Kieran Tini didn't start in the last match.
Yes.
Cedric has been used on that side and he's a right-footer, so maybe I would expect a change. Yeah. Whether Bellerin is going to start, I don't know, because Cedric has been money playing on both sides. For Martin Odegaard, I don't think he's going to start. But in any case, he'll be thrown into the deep end. It might be a guy like Emile Smith-Rowe who's going to suffer there.
In that midfield.
Yeah.
So, it is going to be a cracker tonight. What do you expect from the game?
I expect a really tough game here.
Yeah.
And for Manchester United, they know the job. Because, I mean, losing to Sheffield United in itself was a big, big disaster.
A big disaster. Yeah. They need to recover.
Yeah, they need. We believe it was a blip on the road and they're going to get back to normal business.
Yeah.
Knowing that Manchester United still hasn't beaten Mikel Arteta, I guess it's going to...
It's just one match.
I know it is, but you look at the resume of Ole Gunnar Solskjaer beating the top six managers.
Yes.
Only one box is left to tick, and that's Mikel Arteta.
Mikel Arteta.
Yeah. I can't even believe you're saying Arsenal are top six. Top six teams.
The 254 are hanging out with Joe Sainer and Sammy Gitai here. And then, we are done with Manchester United. Arsenal, this is going to be a big game and everything is going to happen there. Then there's the major one that also happened during the week. Tottenham losing to Liverpool. And you had even the rumors that Sergio Rie had a very dressing room bust-up with some of the players. Tell me.
First off, what happened was quite simple.
Yeah.
Liverpool played against Tottenham's weakness. If you think about it, Tottenham has set up a five-man defense with even Mark Doherty going to the far left also. So if you're going to bomb the two left back, the two wing backs forward and remain with a three behind, and yet there's no enough cover for the likes of Firmino. When he does the creation, there will always be a problem there, because if you're going to do a 3-on-3 and you expect to play on the counter attack against Liverpool, remember they have very pacey wing backs. They will still go back. So
the thing, Joe, will be was Tottenham being a fluke in the early stages of the season, because everybody
Tottenham is a solid team. I believe it's a solid team. I don't think they were a fluke for the first season.
Yeah.
The thing is, it just didn't work for them on a Thursday night.
Yes.
Thursday night, yes.
Yeah.
No. Thursday or Friday night.
Thursday night.
Yeah.
It didn't work for them. Serge Aurier had a tumultuous first half, and hence his substitution and the buster. If you look up forward, you don't tell me Son can't play with any other striker in the world. It has to be Harry Kane.
It has to be.
You see, now that's who's injured. So now if you look, you need another number 9.
Yes.
Ben won't play number 9.
Yeah.
If I am Jose Mourinho, me, I'll go into the free market and get Diego Costa.
Yes.
Come fill in those boots.
Yeah.
Because you need an out and out number 9.
Yeah.
Son is not a number 9.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and you need someone who is going to hold up the game and distribute it to all these first players, even the likes of Lucas Moura.
Yeah. And can now Tottenham sustain themselves? Because reports were from that game that Harry Kane is injured both legs and he might be off for a very lengthy season. Will they manage?
It's going to be tough, but the issue that strikes me hard is looking at Harry Kane. Every time this year he seems to be picking these injuries, and many now have been talking about him. He loves American football, and he now feels like the Super Bowl is near, and you're going to see him maybe in Tampa.
Yeah,
going to be seeing the Super Bowl. We've been seeing him every time in the Super Bowl when Tom Brady is playing.
Yes.
Either way, I guess there's an issue with his ankles, and that's something that should be looked at too.
Yeah.
But for Spurs, I think with a backup who can play in there, they still got Carlos Vinicius in that team.
Yes.
We've seen him score some goals in the FA Cup against Marine. I know it's Marine. But
especially that disgracious first goal.
Yeah.
He was blasting the net for who now?
I guess it's going to be tough for them because you look at that combination between Son and Kane, it's been working for them. Maybe over 70% of the goals have come from them. It's going to be a big call from Jose Mourinho, but still taking on that game between themselves and Liverpool.
Yeah.
I don't know why many people are bashing the players, but I guess we should even be questioning Jose Mourinho on
Jose
the players he went with.
Yes.
And it was really sad for me to listen to him post-game saying that the players cost them the game while himself made some very bad decisions. And again, maybe, could it be time to question Hugo Lloris as a goalkeeper?
For a long time replacement for Hugo Lloris.
Yeah, it's going to be tricky. Mm. I wanted to put you on the deep end, Joe, for a team that you hate. Would you think they need a centre back? Liverpool.
hate is a big word, man. I just dislike the affiliation with Manchester, but yes, they do need a centre back. They always do this makeshift partnership, and they don't seem to work. Not always. Against Tottenham, maybe it did work because Tottenham were not at their top game.
Yes.
But if they meet a Leicester City, a Manchester City, if they meet a West Ham that is solid at the back and just needs one goal and then defends the whole time, they need a strong centre back. I'm not saying that Klopp should go for an £80 million centre back right now. There's no money, obviously, with what has been happening, COVID and all.
Yes.
Transfer budgets are a bit low. But if you can get, when it's a seasoned defender who has been in the Premier League, whether it's someone who can come and directly impact the game, that would be very important. Yeah. But I'm not seeing them doing another £80 million defender. No, I'm not. If I was him, again, I'll go to Leicester City and take Soyuncu. Why not?
Yes, yeah.
Why not?
And actually, when you look at what's happening on the tabloids, they're actually saying that it could be Mustafi would be headed to Liverpool.
Yes, yes. There was also that rumor there.
The World Cup winner.
Yeah, World Cup winner from the bench. But okay.
And then let's also go with that. Manchester City, back on top of the table, one game in hand, and they're playing good football. Do you see them going all the way with this title, even if it's halfway through the season?
I guess, yes. I guess maybe 90% of the football fans are expecting Manchester City to win this. And
I'm the 10%.
Not to win.
Look at their form in the last six games or so, they've won all. Uh-huh. And you look at their defensive record, I guess they have considered the least number of goals in the Prem with 13, and that partnership between John Stones and Ruben Diaz is looking so good. Uh-huh. And a man like Gundogan in the middle, they don't look as if they are missing Kevin De Bruyne.
Wow.
They're also playing as if they are not playing with a number 9 because Gabriel Jesus has not been playing much in match. They still got Raheem Sterling in that team. They look like a real team that could win the championship this season.
Wow, it's a big one for them. What do you say, Joe, when you look at the way Manchester City is playing at the moment?
I mean, I would be dismissive to say that they are not playing good.
Yes,
they are
playing.
I would be dismissive to say that they are not going to give a right old challenge to the Premier League. I would be, but I have to agree that not only the strength in the team, but the camaraderie that they have in terms of the formation, in terms of the setup, in terms of the discipline. If you look at the last two games that Gundogan has played, if you look at his position, if you look at the map, where he is affected, the midfield, he's a guy who can still go forward. He can play in the middle very well. Yes. He can come and offer defensive assistance to the likes of defenders.
Yes.
But more importantly, it's the instillment from Pep to these players that you guys are great.
Yeah.
Liverpool had a blip last season.
Yeah.
You guys need to take back what's rightfully yours.
Yes.
And that's something that players need. Moreover, and I'm not saying Ole Gunnar Solskjaer is not doing it, but Pep has more experience in getting players into that game day mentality.
Mm-hmm.
Well, today, again, if you look at the fixtures,
they're going to storm Sheffield United.
That's the thing.
That's the thing.
They will win against Sheffield United. I can guarantee you that.
With a good number of goals.
They will. Okay?
Yeah.
The same team that was a difficult proposition for Manchester United is the same team that is going to lose to Manchester City.
Yeah.
So, what are we looking at? We're looking at now picking up points.
Picking points.
you need to wait for one person to slip up points.
Yeah.
Because again, if you look behind you, there's Leicester.
There's Leicester.
There's Liverpool coming back.
Yeah.
There's West Ham doing something that no other team is doing. Exactly. Yeah. You get so. Yeah. Thank you. What did you say? Arsenal, best team in London. It has been said. It is West Ham. Crystal Palace almost coming second.
The touchline on Y254 with the Gio Sainer and Sami Gitaya. And we are still talking matters football here on the Fan Zone. And let's talk about two or three transfers that have been happening during this month. This is a month of transfers, and Jesse Lingard is now leaving to West Ham on loan.
Yeah, I expected that, really, because he's not been involved in many matches. I guess he's only played one match this season for Manchester United. And I was looking at the West Ham situation when they were talking about him leaving to the Hammers.
Yeah.
There was two loan deals in that team with Dawson, who just came in, and Said Benrahma.
Yeah.
So they had to complete one as a permanent move, and they went for Said Benrahma for a completed deal of around 15 million. And then Jesse Lingard now is at West Ham. Whether it's a good signing for West Ham, I really don't know, because they have many men in there who could start ahead of him.
Played, I think, very well under David Moyes and Louis van Gaal. Will you miss him as a Manchester United fan? Or
as a fan, yes. Mm-hmm. But in performance-wise, I don't think he was needed. He was surplus to requirements.
Yeah.
But what in hope... But what he'll offer West Ham is that next level pace. We're talking about pace in the team. West Ham generally have not been known as a very fast team.
Yes.
They have Antonio Valencia. You have Mikel Antonio. Who is one of the fastest players in the Premier League.
Yeah.
If you look at other players, you're not seeing any other fast players. But what Lingard can offer is that bursting pace, especially from the middle. If they can get a number 10 out of him, and he can get those first balls forward, I can see more contributions to the strikers, because you've been seeing West Ham have been scoring most of their goals using midfielders.
Maybe a question for you, maybe. You look at the West Ham team in their midfield and attacking going forward, they've got the likes of Gerald Bowen, they've got Pablo Fornals, who's been looking money this time, and also you've got a guy like Said Benrahma supporting Mikel Antonio up front. Do you see Jesse Lingard really getting to that team?
I see him getting to that team when the coach decides to change the system from an out possession back to a counter attacking team.
Is there any way then with the two defensive midfielders like Declan Rice in that team, do you see any means that David Moyes is going to disrupt that in the middle?
The only way he can disrupt it, to be honest, is if he changes his formation from the narrative 4-4-2 to 4-3-3.
Okay.
That's the only way Lingard can play.
Okay, so in the middle, for example, I'm throwing you under the bus here. You've got Thomas Suchek, who's been a huge signing for them.
Yes.
You've got Declan Rice. You're playing three in the middle. Who's the other one? Or who are you dropping for Jesse Lingard?
Well, I would put Jesse Lingard to play with those two that you've just said. Why? And this is important, is because of what Declan Rice and the other guy can do in terms of covering.
Yeah.
But you have a gap, and this is 4-3-3. You have a gap between the midfielders and the strikers. Who's going to cover that midfield, at the same time have the pace even to join that attack to make a four-man attack.
So
you have to look at it from that point of a counter-attack. I'm not saying he's going to fit in immediately to that squad, no. Unless the manager changes.
Yeah.
That's where I see it.
And the way you have seen West Ham coming up on top very, very well.
Mm-hmm.
That is the transfers. Now, my time is not good now, and I don't want to leave this conversation without talking about Frank Lampard.
Yeah.
What went wrong for him?
Sammy, what went wrong? In your opinion first. Because we have like five opinions, but I don't know.
At the beginning, for me, on Monday morning, it was a huge surprise for me to realize that he's been gone. And I expected maybe they would have given him the trust.
Yes.
Well, Pep Guardiola came after that and said there is nothing called a process in game of football.
Yeah.
It's all about results.
Yeah.
And looking at the signings they made at the beginning of the season, 120 million spent on six or so players. And there's been a certain sect of the journalists who have been saying that maybe only one, who is Ben Chilwell, was part of the deals that Frank Lampard wanted. The other one, just club signings.
Yeah.
Getting such amount of players and high caliber players into the team, well, he just done well with some academy players, was a poison chalice for him. And if the results aren't coming, then he had to leave. And we know Chelsea, Roman Abramovich is
he now joins the list of rich managers who have left the game under the hands of Roman Abramovich.
Yes, for
you, Joe, just tell us why. What do you think went wrong for him?
It's not even about what went wrong for him. Yeah. It's what's wrong with that board,
with the Chelsea board. Yes.
Here's the first thing. They took Lampard when they couldn't even make a transfer because they were under a ban. What did he do? He used whatever you gave him, and he got results.
Yes.
Then he told the board, here's the thing. I want to do certain transfers.
Okay.
Some will be done by the club because you guys are looking at merchandise, sales, and all that. And then some I really want because they will improve the team.
Yeah.
To gel all those players between September, October, November, December, January, 5 months
without
a preseason is unfortunate. It's impossible.
Yeah.
They could have judged him next season. After a full season. Okay. To invest, for any successful person, you need to invest.
Yeah.
So they did the investment.
Yeah.
They were not patient for the victory. That's the problem.
Way Manchester United was patient with Ole Gunnar Solskjaer when he had a problem. But when you look at the performance of some of those managers and their performance and their time, Frank Lampard comes really down in the pecking order.
Yeah, and actually you read the mail that was written by Chelsea and Roman Abramovich following that sacking.
Yes.
There was a clear intent that this man had got the faith from the board.
Mm-hmm.
For them saying that Frank Lampard has left the team as a mid-table club without any success or any clear path to success.
Yes.
It was a big statement from the club. But I don't know why Joe is speaking on the board while it has worked in previous times when the soccer manager, the other manager comes in straight in title.
Well, now, the interim managers. We're talking about interim managers. Di Matteo interim.
Yeah.
The Israeli manager, I've forgotten his name.
Abraham Grant
interim title.
Yeah.
Di Matteo Champions League interim.
Yeah.
Look at Solari. Was Solari a fool? Was Solari a fool? Scolari. Was he a fool?
Yeah, employee? Scolari for him was a full-time.
He got a full-time.
Yeah?
So, what I'm saying is it hasn't worked for him. And what I'm saying, this hasn't happened. You're saying this has happened before.
Yeah.
If you look at Liverpool, when he got the job, did he finish in the top four the first season?
For club?
Yes.
No.
He didn't, yeah?
Yeah.
Then what did he do the next season? He told the board, this is what I want to do.
Yeah.
This is the players I want to get. Can I get them? Then can we work on next season?
Yeah.
When Mourinho returned to Chelsea for the first time, he said it's a two horse race with a little donkey.
Yes.
But next season, the donkey will become bigger. That's the idea.
Yeah.
You come first. And for Lampard, it was really unfortunate because he got a team, first of all, that he couldn't make any transfers.
Yes.
So he had to do what he did at Derby with a small budget and try and get some results.
Yeah.
He got the results.
Mm-hmm.
Now he has the budget.
Yeah.
You can't expect him immediately to just have an impact.
Yeah.
You need to give him that whole season. You need to.
You can actually see what happened to Manchester United in a span of 1 year.
Mm.
Yeah, in a span of 1 year, you can look at the way Ole Gunnar Solskjaer changed that
from 14th, 13th.
Yeah, to now, they are fighting for. So let's go ahead and talk of some of the games that will be coming your way this afternoon. We've got early kickoff, Everton playing home to Newcastle, and then Crystal Palace will also be home to Wolves. Manchester City will be playing at home to Sheffield United. West Bromwich Albion versus Fulham is a game that will be one key game to watch there because now it's a relegation battle between those two. And during the night, Arsenal versus Manchester United. Then we'll finish off this match day with Southampton versus Aston Villa. Very little time to go, Joe. Which game will you keeping your eye on away from the Arsenal Manchester United?
Well, Man City, Sheffield United, because I just want to see them score the goals.
Yes.
To be honest, as a fan, you know, right now you have to be very objective about it.
Yes.
Also, the West Brom Fulham game, because of now that relegation battle.
Yes.
And then I think the late night game is going to be entertaining. Southampton versus Aston Villa.
Uh-huh.
Two very attacking teams with the likes of Jack Grealish, Danny Ings.
Yeah.
These guys want to play for the Euros for England. So that's something that they really want to push in terms of their performances. But yeah, Arsenal, Manchester United. Arsenal will get a good game, but they will not win the game. That's all I can say.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now, there's an early kickoff game between Everton and Newcastle. That is a game worth sitting down to watch.
It is, and For Steve Bruce, man, it's going to be tough for him because you look at the run he's had.
Do you think he'll be sacked? He'll be the next manager to be sacked?
No, I don't think so.
You don't think so?
I don't think Mike Ashley is on that trajectory of sacking him. Well, they're sitting pretty tight at 16th.
Yeah.
They could remain in the Prem, and I think that's what matters for Mike Ashley. Just remain in the Prem. Doesn't matter whether you have your own struggles. Doesn't matter whether the fans are on your neck.
Yes.
For him, maybe we could resign, and I've had many telling him that maybe it's time that he should leave the club. Now that Rafael Benitez is free of a job, he doesn't have a job.
Yeah, but you can't give Rafa the job back. Come on.
Yeah,
there's a rumor here that Rafa might go to Celtic, actually.
Yeah, but he's
been linked to that job, too. Uh-huh, yeah. But it's going to be a good match here to watch, especially Pickford after the stinker he had in the last match against Leicester City. Mm-hmm. I didn't expect him to start, but he's been given the confidence by Carlo Ancelotti.
Yeah.
So we'll be watching keenly to see what happens in there.
And then it was also entertaining between Crystal Palace and Wolves, Joe. That's a game also.
It's going to be a very good game. How, again, the Crystal Palace manager has managed to keep this team intact again in London, whereby there's so many other so-called big giants, and they have achieved what they need to achieve. Roy Hodgson needs to be given his fair dues. As for Nuno Espirito Santos, is the Portuguese influence done? Is it?
It might be, but it's still got
okay,
Portuguese.
You look at Wolves right now, they're really lacking a number 9 striker in there. Raul Jimenez has been missing, and they've been short.
Costa is free, they should go for Costa.
Maybe, that could be
They are missing also Jota, the way it was sent by Liverpool.
Yeah, Jota also left the team. You could make a case for him also.
Yes.
For Crystal Palace, I heard some rumors that actually this is the last season for Roy Hodgson. I understand there is going to be a huge rebuild in that team, and maybe you can see the likes of Wilfred Zaha being freed up. We've already seen some of the players being linked away, the likes of Andrew Townsend and the likes.
Yeah.
I don't think it's going to be an interesting match for sure. I expect some very low blocks in this one.
Yeah.
And Wolves might get the win, but maybe through one Pedro Neto goal.
One Pedro Neto. And then, Joe, a very also midweek, we saw Wolves coming, I think, with that draw. One other one was West Brom and Fulham. It is at West Brom. Allardyce lost by 5-0 to Manchester City. He needs to recover. He needs the 3 points. Scott Parker of the Fulham, he has also shown that he can play some good football.
I think this is a West Brom win. Why? Because obviously, yes, they lost 5-0 to Manchester City, but if you see the previous performances that they have put in to rescue, because this is a rescue mission.
Yes.
This has nothing to do with trophies or anything. This is a rescue mission. So against Fulham, integral 3 points are very important, and that's something they will look off to. I'm not saying the team that Scott Parker is going to put out is going to be bad.
Yeah.
It's just that I believe West Brom need this game more than Fulham.
You know, I was looking at the statistics for West Brom and I realized they've conceded a massive 48 goals this season.
Wow. Halfway through the season.
Yeah, that's the worst record you've seen from them. And for Sam Allardyce, he's openly talked about the defensive issues and he's brought in a couple of signings.
Yeah.
I believe he signed by Dyang from Galatasaray this week or from Galatasaray.
Yes.
And for Fulham, I guess they are really performing well. And actually, when you look at the table, I guess Fulham for me is the team that escapes that zone because they've got some lovely players.
Yeah.
You're looking at Ademola Lookman, Ruben Loftus-Cheek, Bobby Dekodova, Reed. They're playing a very good football in there. And whenever you see Scott Parker with a turtleneck, you know, the luck is coming, he's going to win that.
A big game that will be coming. Well, now let's finish off this one quickly. Southampton playing home to Aston Villa at St. Mary's tonight. Southampton, Aston Villa is also a key one. I think all these teams are looking to finish at the top half of the table. And this one also is a cracker.
I have Aston Villa for a win here. I think Arsenal really dented Southampton's sort of push towards, you know, getting the 3 points in the midweek. So Aston Villa again have been on this route. It's a team. Ole Watkins is not performing as the number nine that we want him to perform.
Yes.
To be perfectly honest, he's not.
Yeah.
If you see the chances that he was given, if you'd give some of the Callum Wilson the same chances, he would make them count.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and that again is an opinion. And Sam here is busy trying to, you know, steam you that life. But yeah, for me, yes. I think Aston Villa will win the game tonight.
Okay, yes. I don't know what happened to Rafa Senoso, because this team has won only one game in 7 matches. And uh-huh. they are lacking 2 defenders, of course.
Yeah.
Kyle Walker-Peters and Ryan Bertrand, maybe uh-huh. they'll be missing from this game.
Yeah.
Aston Villa with Jack Grealish, the likes of Matty Target, they are looking so good. So
yeah,
it could be a game where you think Aston Villa are going to win. Whether Ollie Watkins is not a good striker, let me preserve that for another day.
No, I'm not saying he's not a good striker. I'm just saying his conversion rates.
Yes, his conversion.
If you give the same opportunities to Callum Wilson, he's going to convert them. That's all I'm saying.
That is why we finished the touchline here on the Y254. It is a big one. It has been fun here on the fan zone with Joe Saina and Sammy Kitai. Thanks, guys, for coming. The touchline is off till next Saturday. Good afternoon. And let's say a big thank you to everybody who has managed to make this broadcast a success here today. The touchline says goodbye, but be ready for Rock Tour in just a little bit of time.